Welcome back to When Harry Met Board Games, where we feed our people with relatable content and our victory condition is your satisfaction. I'm Harry, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel and hit that bell notification so that when we're doing our thing, YouTube lets you know. Today I continue my top 100 board games of all time, covering my numbers 90 through 81, and we're going to get straight to it. My number 90 board game of all time is King of Tokyo, designed by Richard Garfield and published by Yellow Games. This is a Yahtzee-style dice rolling game where players each take on the role of a different monster or creature who's trying to have dominance over Tokyo or Tokyo Bay, which is represented by these circular spots on this board. Very much abstracted. Really, what's going on is you're rolling these six dice here, and you get up to two re-rolls, so you're rolling a total of three times potentially, and you're either trying to roll for numbers, which score you points, which is one of the ways you could win the game. The first player to score 20 points is the winner, or you're trying to roll claws to deal damage to all the opponents that are not where you're at, and there's only two locations in the game. You're either in Tokyo or outside of Tokyo, or you're trying to roll for these energy symbols, which are basically a sort of currency in the game, represented by these different cubes here, these green cubes, that you use to buy special abilities, these special powered cards that give you either one-time abilities or permanent abilities throughout the game. Really cool, lots of stuff going on. This is a pretty quick game. I'd say it plays in about 15 to 20, maybe 30 minutes. If you play with enough people. But the point is, players are trying to win the game, and they have two different paths for victory. Either score the 20 points first, or defeat and annihilate and crush all your opponents by attacking. And I like that because it gives players the choice to play their style of game. Some people are a lot more confrontational, a lot more vicious and cutthroat, and they get to take that approach, and it's a viable path to victory. Other people are more peacemakers and just want to outperform their opponents by scoring the most points. And again, another viable path of victory. My number 90 board game of all time, King of Tokyo. Now we move on to my number 89. And my number 89 board game of all time is King Domino Duel. And this is a two-player only, as the name indicates, roll and write game, which is a spin-off of the massively popular King Domino, where players are setting their dominoes spatially, creating this grid, and it represents a bunch of different terrains, and they have crowns on the tiles, and you multiply the amount of the crowns by the amount of spaces of the consecutive same terrain type, and that is your score within each of the different terrain types. And then you add them all up, and the winner is the player who has the highest score. This, very similar, except players are rolling dice and basically drafting them. And there's four dice to roll, and the starting player, and that will alternate as the game goes on, the starting player gets to draft first, but then the second player gets to draft two dice in a row, and then leave the last one for the starting player. And basically, the dice make up your virtual tile, your virtual domino that you are going to pencil in your pen and pad grid right here. And basically, the dice, the different faces of the dice, are different banners, right? Different shields here with different symbols and patterns on them. And you're trying to, again, get contiguous or adjacent areas with the same symbols and multiply their crowns, which are represented by these little cross symbols here on the upper left-hand corner of the dice. These, you're trying to multiply those crosses by the amount of spaces in that type. And you're also trying to unlock these special abilities, because once you've rolled a certain amount of, or you've played a certain amount of dice of the same type, the same pattern, you unlock a special ability. Only one player can unlock each of the different special abilities. And again, it's a once a turn or once a game ability that gives you a major advantage in this game. I like the challenge and the puzzle of this more than King Domino. I think King Domino is definitely a more appealing game and a more gateway game. And of course, it accommodates more than just two players, so it has its advantages in that sense. But I actually prefer the challenge and the puzzle of King Domino Duel myself. My number 89 board game of all time, King Domino Duel. Now we move on to my number 88 board game of all time. And this was new for me this year. So this game, again, was number 48 last year. It's dropped down to number 88, 40 spots, and that is Merchants of Amsterdam, designed by Reiner Knizia and published by Rio Grande Games. If you've been following my channel, you know that I've mentioned this game from time to time. Lots of people have never heard of this game. This game was published in 2000. And even in this calendar year, Reiner Knizia published or designed some very successful games in his repertoire. So this game kind of gets lost in the shuffle in that regard. But this is a really cool game with some neat area majority going on. Some auction bidding, right? We have this Dutch auction timer, which is the gimmick of the game. And basically, players are slamming this, and based on where it lands, that's how much you're willing to pay for the current auction. And also players are just trying to vie for majority in the three different spheres of this game. And this board, brace yourself, it's an ugly looking board, terrible graphic design, terrible artwork. But basically there's three spheres. You have the four quadrants or the four corners of the earth. You have Amsterdam, the city of Amsterdam, and you have the different shipping lines. And each of these areas are divided into four, or broken down into four individual smaller areas. And players are vying for majorities and secondaries in these areas, because at the triggering of certain scoring rounds throughout the game, you will score points if you are the majority or the secondary in these areas. Also, if your area is more valuable because it's more densely populated, there's more people involved in that area, that's actually going to score you more points than if you are the lead player in a less significant area on this board. Really cool. But the neatest thing about this game is the way the turn order works, because players are going to be drafting cards, three cards per turn, one at a time, and making their decisions one at a time before moving on to the next one as to whether or not they're actually going to keep that card all for themselves, discard that card altogether, or the third option is put it up for auction, where you can win it, but all other players can compete in said auction as well. And that is really cool, because there's a little bit of press your luck. Sometimes you're thinking you're getting rid of trash, hoping to draw something better, but things might not result that way. Or the opposite might happen, where you think, hey, this is as good as it's gonna get, and later on in the round, you're forced to discard an amazing card because you weren't anticipating it. Really cool. If the graphic design were better, if the components were better, this game would probably rank even higher on my list. But as it is, it's already my number 88 board game of all time, Merchants of Amsterdam. My number 87 board game of all time actually has dropped down significantly. This was ranked number 22 for me a year ago, and it's dropped over 60 spots, but it's still in my top 100. My number 87 board game of all time is Dice Hospital, designed by Stanislav Kordonski and Mike Nudd, and this is published by Alley Cat Games. Again, this game was ranked very highly for me. I've kind of grown cold on it. The fact that my wife, Lily, who I mainly play with it, is not as huge of a fan of it. And also the fact that it's very multiplayer solitaire-like, right? Because even though this is a worker placement game, each player has their own hospital board, and those are their worker placement spots. So nobody else could actually interfere with your worker placement. The only actual interaction that this game actually has is that at the beginning of the round, you have a drafting of your patients, which are represented by different color-coded dice, and you have a drafting of certain upgrades for your hospital, either units that you add to your hospital board or your hospital building, or specialists, right, that you get their meeples and you add them to your pool of meeples or workers for your worker placement. And the different specialists give you different abilities, and the different units also have different advantages and benefits corresponding with the three different colors of the dice or of your patients. And basically, you're trying to run as efficient a hospital as possible, and you're trying to discharge your patients effectively and quickly, right? Promptly. Because if patients are not treated and discharged, ultimately they end up being neglected. They lower in pip value and ultimately can die, which will lose you points in the game. But you're also trying to discharge in big clusters, right? Because if you discharge just a patient or two, you're only going to get a few points. But exponentially, the amount of points you get increases if you're able to discharge a big chunk of patients at the same time. So you're trying to calculate your decisions to set yourself up for rounds where you can discharge 4, 5, maybe even 6 or 7 patients all at one shot and rack in a lot of points. You're manipulating your different meeples, your different specialists, your different units, and you're mapping out the puzzle, and in particular, the sequence in which you trigger your different worker placement actions. Because again, there is no interference from your opponents, but the sequence, the order in which you choose to trigger these different abilities, determine how successful and how effective they will be. Again, as a person who's worked in the medical industry, and my wife as well, still works in the medical industry today, this game appeals to me, it speaks to me, I like the puzzle behind it, but again, it has dropped significantly because multiplayer, it's not as interesting or as competitive as I would prefer for it to be. But even so, it's still ranked number 87 on my all-time board game list, Dice Hospital. Now we move on to my number 86, and my number 86 is Mission Red Planet, designed by Bruno Cathala and Bruno Faduti. And this game was also ranked significantly higher on my list last year. I actually had this ranked as high as number 32 last year. So this game has dropped a ton. This game is a nice area majority game, science fiction, steampunk, where players are trying to colonize the planet of Mars and send their different astronauts into all these different regions. And basically what's going on is you have this role selection at the beginning of each round where you have 9 different roles, and each player has the same set of 9 roles that they're choosing, and they're all numbered from 1 through 9, and you simultaneously pick them, simultaneously reveal them, but then you trigger their effects in numerical order, counting down from 9 all the way through 1. And basically these different roles give you a special ability of actually sending astronauts to the different ships, to launch different ships, to move around and manipulate and maneuver around the actual planet, to do something on Phobos, the moon of the planet, or to actually do some take that attacking actions against your opponents that hurt them, right? And basically you're trying to have the majorities in these different areas, you're trying to gain the resources that each of the different regions have, and you reveal them as the game progresses, and some of the resources are more valuable than others. But there's also some secret scoring going on, because each player starts the game with 1 secret mission that will score them certain points depending on whether or not they can accomplish what the actual mission card says. And your opponents do not know what that mission is. As the game progresses, they might start to decipher and speculate as to what those missions might be, but they might be totally off for all they know. Really cool, really fun. This plays really well at multiple players. It's been a while since I've been able to get a 3 or 4 player game of this, and that's probably one of the reasons why it's gone down on my list. But even so, it's still pretty high. My number 86 board game of all time, Mission Red Planet. My number 85 board game of all time was actually ranked number 63 last year. So it didn't actually make it to my top 50 board games of all time videos, but it was on my top 100 board games of all time. And this year, it's number 85, and that is Kings of Israel, which is a Bible-themed cooperative game where players are taking on the roles of different prophets from Israel who are trying to combat the wickedness that's in the land, which is represented by different black cubes that you're using actions to eliminate before the entire nation gets overwhelmed by these black cubes and the players lose the game. This is very much a pandemic style of game. Lots of ideas and concepts have been borrowed with a different theme. And I like those type of cooperative games. I don't even have a big fan of Pandemic, but I'm a big fan of that cooperative game where you have some sort of threat deck that you're constantly interacting with, that there's some idea or predictability, but at the end of the day, you're at the expense, you're at the mercy of the different cards that come out. And I like the different player powers that each individual prophet can provide for the different players. And basically, you're going down this track, represents all these different wicked kings throughout Israel. And every once in a while, there's a good king. And the good king, when you are in a turn of a good king, you're going to have a little bit of help. But every time that you go through a bad king, there's some disasters, some bad things that are going to happen, right? Some punishments that the nation of Israel is going to have to deal with. And then you are going to have to clean up that mess as the prophets. Really cool, really fun. Radu, the world-renowned, famous board game reviewer Rado, actually says that he thinks that this is a better gateway into the world of cooperative games than Pandemic itself. So you should check it out. I do have a playthrough of this video for those who are curious. My number 85 board game of all time, Kings of Israel. And now we move on to my number 84 board game of all time. And this is a new game to the list this year, a new game to me. And again, you want to talk about cooperative board games with that kind of threat deck that you're dealing with. And you've got this right here. Tiny Epic Defenders, designed by Scott Alms and Gamelin Games. This is a Tiny Epic game, the second one in my list so far. And basically, these are small games with small components, small table space. Well, not always so much small table space, but they're smaller games that are very travel friendly, but they pack a punch. They're a good, solid, crunchy, legitimate game. And in this game, players are all taking the role of different fantasy-raced heroes that have different unique abilities from one another. And there is an ultimate bad guy that you're trying to defeat. But in the meantime, you have smaller enemies and dire enemies that are attacking the different cities that make up the board, right? You basically have a city. You have seven different little boards here that make up the area, the kingdom. And one of them is the capital city, which is the most important one that you're trying to defend. But you're trying to defend all the outer regions as well, because once they become destroyed, then the capital of the city is compromised and will be more vulnerable and susceptible to attack. And you're doing all these things, and players have a certain pool of actions that they can take to lower the threat in all of these different regions, to heal themselves. There's some artifacts that you gain as you defeat certain enemies. You win the reward of certain artifacts that give you special abilities going forward in the game. And then ultimately, eventually, you have to defeat the big bad, the big boss. And if you're able to do so before the capital of the city is destroyed, then the players have won the game. And again, you're dealing with this threat deck and trying to anticipate and speculate as to what's there. You have a good idea of what's there. The threat deck each round keeps on getting shuffled, but you have a harder card is inserted in the deck at the end of each round, right? The deck starts out very easy with pretty much no difficult cards. And then every round you add one more card that's a little bit juicier, a little bit meatier, and a little bit more challenging. And finally, again, you're doing this until either the capital city runs out, or until it's destroyed, or until you are able to defeat the final boss. And if you do so, the players are the winners. Again, nice cooperative game, a challenging puzzle to figure out. Lots of Scott Alms' Tiny Epic games are very puzzly in nature, and this one is no different in that regard. My number 84 board game of all time, Tiny Epic Defenders. My number 83 board game of all time is a tie between two games, which are pretty much the same game with a different title and a different theme. And last year, this game was actually ranked number 69 for me, so it hasn't dropped too much considering how many new games have come in the last year. And basically, let me get straight to it. My number 83 is Star Realms and Hero Realms. And this is a quick deck building game. One is with a fantasy theme, another one is with a science fiction theme. Both of them have lots of expansions, lots of content, ways that you could play it cooperatively, competitively, two players, multiplayer, and even campaign mode, right? Both of these games have that content out there for it if you want to play it. I have to admit, lately I've been gravitating more to Hero Realms because of its thematic feel. It just feels a little bit cooler and interesting to me, but I could see why for some people Star Realms is the better way to go. And there are some small nuanced differences from the game, but for the most part they play the same. Players are building their deck of attack cards and currency cards that allow them to buy more cards, and basically you're using an attack to either defeat your human competitors, or if you're playing the game cooperatively, there's some sort of boss or ultimate agenda that you have to defeat in order to win the game. Really cool, really quick deck builder. My number 83 board game of all time, Star Realms / Hero Realms. And now we move on to my number 82 board game of all time. And this is also a deck building game. And this game was ranked number 64 on my list last year. So it also has dropped down a bit, but not too much. My number 82 board game of all time is DC Deck Building Game. And I have to admit, this game, the base game and the competitive game, would not rank nearly as high. But I like playing this game in particular with the Crisis Mode, which first of all makes the game cooperative. Second of all, it adds some storyline progression to the game, some nice and interesting crises or challenges that the team of players have to overcome in order to ultimately defeat the supervillains. I find that to be cool and neat. It feels more thematically accurate because when you defeat villains, they don't necessarily go into your deck, even though there are some exceptions. They just get defeated and go to the destroy pile. But in particular, I like playing this crisis mode with my variant and my modifications that I make, because crisis mode adds lots of length to the game. One of the biggest knocks on crisis is how long the game can take. So if you want to check out the way I play DC deck building crisis, you could check my playthrough of the game, which is on the channel. But yes, this game here, if I play with crisis, I take out lots of cards. I have a very specific deck that I construct so that I could play a game that's decent length and at the same time still feels that it gives me the feeling that I like, the things that the crisis mode evokes in me as a player and as a human being. I can still get that from the game, albeit in a shortened game time. So that is why this is ranked number 82 in my all-time board game list, DC Deck Building. And now we move on to the last board game for this video, my number 81 board game of all time, which is new to the list this year, and that is Castles of Burgundy, the card game, designed by Steffenfeld and published by Ravensburger Games. This game basically, first of all, aside from being very travel friendly, it allows you to get lots of the same ideas, the same concepts, and the same feelings that Castles of Burgundy brings. It allows you to experience that in a smaller version of the game, right? First of all, this game is significantly longer than Castles of Burgundy, I find, at least at two players. And also, it takes up much less table space, and again, it's very travel-friendly in this small, compact box right here. And basically, you're getting some set collection. You're trying to collect the different sets of cards in the seven different colors. And if you're the first to get to a group of three, you become, you get the extra victory points for that set, plus the baseline victory points that that set gives you, right? Each set, each different colored set has an intrinsic value in and of itself. But if you're the first player to get it, you'll get a bonus. If you're the first player to complete seven, for example, you'll get a bonus. If you have different types of animals, you'll get a bonus. If you trade in goods, you'll get a bonus, right? And basically, what's interesting, this replaces the dice rolling mechanism of the game with cards that have dice symbols on them. So basically, those dice symbols, they allow you to know what dice those cards need in order to be acquired and in order to be built and added to your tableau or to your estate. But also, those cards, when they're flipped from your dice deck, basically serve as a virtual die, which you will use in order to carry out your decisions, right? Just like in Castles of Burgundy, the regular game, you're using your dice to determine what actions you could do. You could draft cards from a general pool, you can place them in your estate, or you can turn them in for workers to set yourself up in the future rounds in order to mitigate the luck, or you can turn them in for silver. So many different things you could do in this game. And they add some really neat twists that actually make it feel different than Castles of Burgundy. Also, for me personally, a player, a gamer who likes card management over dice rolling, it actually feeds me as a player in that regard, because I feel like I'm a little bit more control. Yes, there's still lots of luck because you have all these cards that can have any of the three of six different sides of the die, but you just feel a little bit more in control. At least I do psychologically. So that is my number 81 board game of all time, Castles of Burgundy. And that's it for today, folks. Thank you so much for joining us. Comment down below. Click one of these videos that you see on the screen right now. If YouTube is showing them to you, it's because there's a good chance that you will like them. Also, check in the description down below so that you can see and check out my Patreon and see how you can support this channel and become involved in the process. This is Harry saying take care, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy, and have fun gaming. Bye-bye.